First off, I'd like to apologize about the inconsistent audio quality. This is my first review, and I'm still trying to work out the kinks. Also, I'd like to thank Derek Bittner of Good Vibes Gaming for giving me advice on how to format this review, and I'd like to thank Sergeant Dr. Funk for giving me feedback after reading my review script. Links to find both their Twitch channels in the description. Alright, so Neo, the world ends with you. It's the sequel to The World Ends With You on the DS that devoted fans such as myself have been waiting for quite a while now. While the first game, which I'm probably going to be referring to as 12E or the DS one or something along those lines. Anyway, while the DS one of course had many of the strengths of JRPGs, including colorful characters, strong character development, and excellent writing, it also had plenty of unique traits for a JRPG at the time. It was just oozing with lots of style and charm, which I notice is a bit of a trend in games that focus around the Shibuya area. Anyway, it also had a unique battle system, which I think was fantastic, that made you focus on both screens, one for the protagonist, Neku, and another for his partner. You would shift your attention from the top screen to the bottom screen, or vice versa, as you defeated enemies. Now, depending on who you ask, the battle system was either fantastic or was full of jank. I can personally see some of the complaints, but I think that if you get used to it, it's really not that bad. Though the original game has been re-released on Switch as The World Ends With You Final Remix, I'm willing to bet a lot of people haven't played or haven't finished Final Remix or even the DS version. With that in mind, I feel I should mention this review will have some spoilers for the DS version and Final Remix, as well as mild ones for the beginning of Neo, so be wary if you still want to finish the original. Now, if you haven't played the DS one or Final Remix, this may be a bit confusing, but I'm going to try to explain the premise the best I can. Bear with me on this. So Neo starts off with our protagonist Rindo and his friend Fred entering the Reaper's game after acquiring some pins that are catching on in popularity in Shibuya, Japan. In this Reaper's game, everything appears pretty normal at first, but they're actually in the UG. The UG is an alternate plane that looks pretty much exactly like the regular world, which is known as the RG. People in the UG can observe those on the RG, but can't directly interact with them. People in the RG are completely unaware of what happens in the UG. What's more is that people in the UG are able to use strange powers by utilizing pins. These powers are called psychs, and range from telekinesis to energy swords to energy blasts, and things of that nature. Players in the Reaper's game are also able to scan their surroundings. Scanning can be used to read the minds of player in the RG, and to fight the monsters called Noise, which they have to use their psychs to defeat. Players group up into teams to take on Noise and earn points in the game by clearing missions. Survive 7 days of the Reaper's game and have more points than the other teams, and you get to leave the game and get back to your normal life. The story itself is decent, though a lot less about personal growth than the first game. Part of me can't help but feel like Neo's story is a lot less engaging at points because of that less personal connection, but that may just be my expectations being too high, I'm not sure on that. Still, it's something to keep in mind. Without spoiling too much, character development is a lot more subtle and isn't really focused until the latter portion of the game. For comparison's sake, Neku from the first game started off extremely standoffish and hated interacting with others in any circumstance. His world ended with himself because he didn't open up and let others inside. That concept was and is a great idea for the protagonist of a JRPG, especially considering most JRPGs have a target demographic of teenage boys. As the story progressed, you saw Neku grow and care more about people, and you became invested in him and his relationship with others. By the end of 12E, you saw a definite, clear growth in him, and that's unfortunately something Neo doesn't have much of. As for the gameplay, as you progress in Neo, you get more teammates. Unlike the original 12E, you don't just have one partner at a time, you instead have several teammates at once, with Rindo being the leader. Each teammate may have their own unique powers that allow you to interact with people in the RG in a limited capacity. For example, Fret has the power to remind people of things they've forgotten, and Nagi can dive into people's minds to erase noise that may be possessing them. Rindo's power is a bit more integrated into the story, and as such, I feel detailing it here would lead to a spoilery tangent, so I just won't bother for now. Of all the powers, the only one I genuinely dislike is Fret's. In order to use his power, you have to point both control sticks in a certain direction in order to make a picture come into focus. The game doesn't tell you which direction to point them in, so it usually boils down to trying to focus one half with one control stick, then once that's in focus, pointing the other in another direction until the whole thing is clear. One problem with that is that the directions they need to be pointed in is really precise, and with both PS4 controllers and Joy-Cons having potential to drift, I was always worried that it would act up again during one of these moments. Another, and perhaps even more important issue, is that it requires no learned skill from the player at all. If you can pass the first challenge, you can pass them all. It starts to feel like a waste of time whenever the remind power comes up because you never wonder, ooh, how am I gonna get past this one? Instead, it's purely routine and I honestly think it could have been replaced or removed altogether. Anyway, moving on to the battles. Battles are extremely different to any version of the first game, though that's unsurprising as this game was also released on the PS4, which doesn't really have a good way to use touchscreen controls. Battles are initiated the same way as in the original for the most part. You scan and choose which noise symbols you want to battle, though now you walk into them instead of tapping them. You can still chain battles together like in the first game, and like in that one, each successive round will be harder than the previous. The draw of chaining battles together is the same. More battles means higher drop rates and extra experience points for you and your pins. Also like the first game, each pin has a psych that can be used when equipped. However, in Neo, each teammate can only use one pin at a time. Each pin also has a certain button assigned to it that can't be changed, though you can change who the pin is assigned to before battle. As for the actual combat part of battles, just like in the original, after using the psych enough, you'll need to wait for it to recharge. However, in Neo, for most pins, you can stop using its psych before it's completely drained, and it will still recharge. On the Switch, the only buttons that activate regular psychs are X, Y, L, R, ZL, and ZR. Some psychs activate by holding the button, others by charging and releasing, and others by rapidly tapping the button. It's not as cumbersome as it seems like it would get, as the designers were smart and made sure that the shoulder buttons always had either the hold to activate or charge and release to activate psychs, while the X and Y buttons have the rapidly tap to activate psychs. The other two face buttons, A and B, don't have equipable pins. Instead, the B button is used to dodge enemy attacks, and the A button is used to unleash special psychs called mashups once certain conditions are met. We'll be getting back to them a bit later. Each psych also has a B drop activation requirement, which may range from landing a combo finisher, to tossing an enemy into the air, to inflicting a status ailment. Fulfill one of these requirements in battle, and a B drop gauge will appear over the enemy. Hit the enemy you're targeting with a different psych before the gauge empties, and you'll activate a B drop and earn groove percentage. Both the character who activated the B drop gauge, and the character who hit the enemy while the gauge was decreasing, will then be ready to help in the A button mashup once groove hits 100%. It's a lot like sync rate in the final remix version of TWELVE, only a bit more timing based. The more characters who participate in B drops, the more powerful the mashup will be when you activate it, and the more likely the enemy is to drop pins. This battle system may not be as different as TWELVE's DS version, where you had to swap your attention between two screens, but I'll give it that it's still a very innovative system. The system of beat drops and mashups is a really great idea that meshes well with the other mechanics. I often find myself thinking, should I use my mashup immediately to thin out enemies a bit, or should I wait until I have more people ready to participate in the mashup to maximize damage and pin drops? Since you can chain battles together, it also makes you think about whether you want to use your mashup on an early round and build up your groove again, or if you'd rather save it for a later round where the enemies are tougher. I actually enjoyed the battle system more than I expected, and would say it's one of the highlights of my experience. Unfortunately, I feel the game doesn't explain the mechanics as well as it could for how quickly it expects you to get the hang of them. As I touched on before, each battle makes your pins stronger, and some pins evolve after given enough growth. Unlike the original, you are now given the option of whether you want to evolve a pin or leave it as is. Those who have played the original may remember getting points for having pins equipped while the game isn't being played. This mechanic is gone, but there are still alternate ways of evolving pins. The game just doesn't explain to you how that works up front. Instead, you have to get the skill to learn alternate methods of evolution using friendship points, a mechanic I'll explain soon. Pignoids also make a return with unique ways of defeating them and a guaranteed pin drop from each one you fight. Now about the friendship points. You get these for completing various objectives in the game and they can be used to get skills that will help you. The catch is, you need to befriend people before you can spend these points. The ways to befriend people vary, but the good thing is, as long as you've met the person in question, you can view both the requirements to befriend them and the reward for using your friendship points on them in your social network, which is basically your affinity chart. If you played the original game, you may be slightly off-put by this because some things that were previously unlocked from the start, for example the pig noise indicator, are now locked behind these skills. Overall, I honestly don't know how to feel about the friendship system. On the one hand, it's executed pretty well and isn't too hard to know what to do to fill it out. But on the other hand, it feels a lot like they took a step backward from the previous game. Not only is the social network a bit of a pain to fill out completely, there are exactly enough friendship points to fill it out and no more, but if you want to get all their secret reports, you'll need to fill it all out. Not only that, but exactly how to get more friendship points you need at any given time may be unclear, meaning you may know what skill you want and have the person unlocked on your social network, but don't have the points to activate it and reap your reward. If there is a silver lining in the friendship point system, it's that in Neo, you can replay days pretty early on in. This allows you to grind if you feel the enemies are too tough where you currently are in the story, or go back and get friendship points you know you missed. Even better is that when you want to hop back to where you were, you can start right from where you left off. The downside of replaying previous days is that you can't skip dialogue, only fast forward through it, and if you want to 100% the game without a guide, you'll be replaying days a lot. I don't really understand why they made it that way, considering you can review the text if you missed anything and forgot what to do. You'll also have to redo any puzzles on prior days the legit way, even if you know the answers. Overall, I'd say while unlocking day replays early on is a nice feature, it's soured a bit by the need to go through everything again. Next, let's move on to the difficulty. Neo is challenging, and I mean very challenging, at times. Luckily, you have difficulty options that can be changed at any time you're on the overworld, just like in the original. If you're struggling, you can drop the difficulty down to easy, though you will be rewarded with different pins on different difficulties. Typically, higher difficulty means better pins, though like in the previous game, higher difficulties must be unlocked. Also like the original, you can lower your level to increase the drop rate of pins. An interesting thing about levels in this game is that they only affect HP. Other stats are increased by equipping clothes, or perhaps even more importantly, eating food. The game sort of glosses over the importance of eating food to increase stats, only really mentioning it once. However, this is a very important mechanic in this game, much more so than in the original. In Neo, every character has preferences on what to eat. Give them something they like, and you have a chance for extra stat growth. Plus, like I said earlier, level ups only increase HP. When ordering, each character must have something to eat, or you won't be able to order. You can only eat so much food before you need to digest it. In order to digest food, fight battles, and your fullness gauge will decrease. As long as you don't go over 100% fullness, you can eat as much as you want, then fight battles to decrease it a bit so you can eat more. However, if you go above 100%, you'll need to fight enough battles to get it back to 0% before you can eat again. Luckily, there is no hard limit on how much you can eat per real world day like Twelwe had. This system is loads better than the original in my opinion. In Twelwe, eating food was this strange double-edged sword where you can only eat so much per real world day before the clock would have to roll over for you to eat larger meals again. In fact, it's one of the few cases where I'd say playing the original is detrimental to learning this mechanic. Even once I'd realized the importance of food, I figured if I went over 100% fullness, I'd have to wait a full real world day before I could eat again. That isn't the case at all, and I feel a lot of things I struggled with throughout the game could have been improved with knowing how important food was. My only complaint for how food and level ups themselves work is that when you lower your level, since you're only lowering HP, you'll still defeat weaker enemies in a few hits when going back to replay previous days. You could switch to weaker pins, but since alternate pin decks have to be unlocked in this game, you may need to memorize which pins you had on before, and remember to put them back on when you want to progress the story, which makes it all a bit cumbersome. As for equipment, the bravery system of the first game has been done away with, and how abilities work has been changed. Now anyone can equip any clothing piece, but if the character has enough style, they will also get its ability when they wear it. In order to increase style, you need to eat food. This is part of why I wish I knew just how important food was earlier. By the time I realized I wasn't getting a lot of the abilities, I was so far in that I couldn't get the abilities easily from eating and grinding. On the plus side, you'll get the base stat boosts from clothing no matter what. Also new to Neo is that each character can wear a full outfit instead of being relegated to 4 clothing items. Not much to say about this change other than it's nice to be able to have more abilities at once. Speaking of abilities, while you no longer need to befriend shopkeepers to unlock the abilities of your clothes, there is still a purpose for buying all the clothes in a shop. The more clothes you buy, the higher the VIP level you get for that store chain. Higher VIP levels increases store selection, and you also need to get to VIP level 3 out of 5 maximum to add the clerk as a friend in your social network. While not much different from the original's friendship gauge, it's nice they gave some other incentive to buy all the brands. Lastly, I'll talk about the graphics and audio. Just like its predecessor, this game has lots of style. Think of Persona 5 in terms of the vibes it gives off if you haven't played the original Twelwe. I was a bit worried when I saw the game shifted to 3D but still kept 2D artwork for non-pre-rendered cutscenes, but honestly it works well and doesn't really clash as much as I thought it might. As for the pre-rendered cutscenes, they were a bit off-putting at first. It goes for that sort of pseudo 2D 3D style that The World Ends With You the animation had, but I got used to it over time. It also helps that the animation is much smoother here than in the show. As always, the music is amazing, though I do feel it relies too much on remixes of songs from the previous game. There were a few songs in which I could barely tell if it was a new mix or if it was an old remix with the words Neo Mix slapped on the title. However, that doesn't stop the soundtrack from being absolutely amazing. The new songs and the remix old ones are both phenomenal in their own right. As for the voice acting, it's pretty solid. Not particularly spectacular, but that's more so due to the style of the game. When there are emotional scenes though, they really deliver. As for my overall thoughts, I enjoyed the game. While it was less character-driven than the original Twelwe, it also tried to not rely too heavily on the original game as its crutch, which I can respect. Although I will say, it sometimes felt like they were trying too hard to avoid retreading ground, even if it was to Neo's detriment. Still though, when playing the game, I always wanted to see what happened next. Part of that, of course, is due to me knowing how good the writing was in the first game, but I think Neo stands pretty well in its own merits. If you have the time and money, and like JRPGs, I'd say chances are you'll love this game. If you played the original on DS or played Final Remix on Switch in dock mode, and didn't like the way the game controlled, I'd say this game is easier to control and you'll probably enjoy its gameplay a lot more. Neo also has a demo which can transfer data to the full version if you want to try it out first. While this game didn't quite reach the high hopes I had for it, it's still a very great game. I may save my full thoughts on it for a spoiler discussion though, as the story is tied heavily to the parts I feel could have been done better.